This is Geektastic Weekly, episode 1 for the week of July 3rd, 2015. Heavensward.
And this is our inaugural show. Very first episode of Geektastic Weekly. And, you know, we've been wanting to do this for a while. I've been thinking about doing a show here on YouTube. And I was trying to figure out exactly what kind of subjects to talk about. And I thought, you know, there's a lot of shows out there about gaming. There's a lot of shows about game reviews, but there's not really that much about commentary, about gaming news and commentary about game reviews, where, you know, you just don't sit down with some person and just reading from a script and telling you, you know, game is like this and such, but just two people just sitting down and basically BSing about the game and telling people, you know, what they think about it. And I thought, you know, let's do a game that's sort of that format. Completely unscripted. This is our first show, so please be gentle. So before we get into it, I thought we would cover some news from the interwebs, the latest gaming news.
Gaming news.
Yes. All right, our first news of the day. Warner Brothers launched Arkham Knight for the PC, fully well knowing that it was broken. In fact, from what I understand, they knew a whole year before the game launched. A whole year before it was launched. It wasn't developed by Rocksteady. Rocksteady did the original development for the PS4 and Xbox One version on the Unreal 3.5 engine. Another company called Iron Galaxy was outsourced to do the development for the PC version. And they used NVIDIA GameWorks to do it. And GameWorks is an unoptimizable piece of crap. It's shipped in binaries, so the developers don't have access to source code.
Well, that's never good.
It does unnecessary tessellation on AMD and older NVIDIA cards to deliberately break performance. And tessellation is where polygons are broken down into smaller polygons to make smoother surfaces. Smoother curves, greater detail.
Well, on newer hardware that might work fine, but on older hardware that's not going to go well.
No, it's not going
to go well at all on older hardware.
It's an unoptimized mess. And WB pulled the game after...
They pulled Arkham Knight?
They pulled Arkham Knight off of store shelves and off of Steam.
Wait, this is the new one?
This is the new one.
And they're unselling it?
They're unselling it to fix it.
Oh, that's not going to go over well, because what about anybody who hasn't even had it yet?
I've currently got it. The store page is still there. It's just that sales are suspended until it's fixed. Further sales.
Huh. So, if you don't already have it, if you were waiting and just were doing something else, and okay, I'm going to go try Arkham Knight. Wait, I can't get it now.
You're pretty much screwed until they release the fixed version.
And do they have an ETA on this?
Not currently.
So, it could be tomorrow or 6 months from now.
Yeah, Rocksteady would basically have to take over development of the PC version and strip out GameWorks code. Maybe even move development to Unreal 4.
What I would have recommended, if it had been me, I would have recommended, okay, you screwed the game up. Just put it out there for free then. Screw it. You've already screwed it up. You already botched it. And let people play what's broken. Even if it's broken, at least let them be able to see it, because maybe some people on their systems might be able to run it. But you're saying, we have a busted game. Then the new one, after you fixed it and got all your bugs out, then you can go back to selling it. Yeah, this kind of busted way to do it. But hey, you know, you break it, you buy it.
WB's got this bad habit of doing stuff like this.
You've basically got a handful of people who can play it, and everyone else can't.
Yeah.
And to me, that's way more imbalanced.
Now, Steam refunds were instrumental in doing this, because previously, it was hard to get a refund on Steam, and you could request one in your entire lifetime of your account. Well, now you can request a refund on games as long as you don't have 2 hours on your playtime.
So everyone who had it was broken just went ahead and got their refund.
They went ahead, got their refund.
That was a good idea.
And
that was a way to do that.
Was instrumental in making this happen. This is unprecedented. Interesting, based on what the main focus of this show is going to be about. A broken game being pulled or being shut down. Interesting idea.
There are different ways to handle this kind of a situation when the better thing for the company to actually do their QAs before they let it out the door. Mm-hmm. But sometimes, especially something like this, if it was that bad, they should have caught this long before it hit the door.
Yeah. From my understanding, they knew a year before launch.
They knew a year. So, see, they have no excuse. Yeah. They have no excuse for that at all. If they know that, hey, this is a poor performing system or performing game, mm-hmm. our test show, it's crap. We don't want to release this yet until we've got it fixed. Hey, you know, it's bad business. It really is.
All right. Sony spokesman says that The Last Guardian was saved by the fans who kept asking about it. Several years ago at E3, The Last Guardian was shown for the PS3. Basically a game where a young boy walks around through a ruined puzzle.
Temple business. Temple
basically, or an ancient temple.
Okay.
With physics puzzles. And his companion is this giant white feathered dog like chimera with the feet of a hawk.
Nice to have big friends.
Yes. And people,
that's what that one was.
Completely okay. Abuzz about the game. And it went into development hell and basically vanished for several years. And then recently at Sony's latest E3 conference this year, they showed it off and said it's finally coming.
So how is it that the fans applied pressure to Sony to actually pull this thing out of oblivion?
It was basically going to be canceled because they were running into technical issues with the game.
Okay.
On the PS3. They were running into technical issues in the game and they were just basically going to drop it.
So it's coming to the PS4 now, so that way in other words, they just overcome it with technology in this case.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, this game's possible on the current gen system.
Sometimes it happens. Sometimes an idea comes too soon that the technology can't support it yet. Mm-hmm. And then when you get a level of technology that says, okay, we have the resources overall, we can now do this, and then you can finally do the game proper, do it justice.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of people are calling this the spiritual successor to another game for the PS2 called Ico.
Ico as an Echo or Ico?
Ico. Where basically I've never played it myself. I've seen YouTube videos. You play as a young boy escorting this girl through a castle and you're trying to protect her. You're this young boy with this young girl's hand. You're pulling her by the hand and leading her through the castle. Well, not. You're leading her through the castle.
Right, right.
Essentially.
You're basically being the knight in shining armor type of role.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Call of Duty crybabies are whining that there is no multiplayer in Fallout 4. Apparently, there's going to be a dedicated button for grenades, and that had Call of Duty gamers hoping that there was going to be some kind of multiplayer. Or such, and
well,
some have been.
Bethesda, Elder Scrolls, Fallout games aren't known for their multiplayer.
No,
and when they do try ESO, that it's not exactly what you had in mind. They are more the genre of the single player, long term, deep immersion game.
Yeah,
they're always better at that. If you want to play Call of Duty style games, go play Call of Duty.
Yeah, it was mostly speculation based on. Footage that was shown of the game where there was a dedicated counter for grenades on the HUD.
Dedicated counter.
The fact that the main character was seen throwing a grenade with his left hand and holding his gun with his right.
It doesn't necessarily mean you're going to have multiplayer. That just means he can good with grenades.
Well, that's the way it's done in COD.
Okay. They thought they were getting something similar.
Yeah.
Surprise.
Yeah, it's... Hasn't been very... The whining hasn't been widespread, but it's been a thing.
It can happen.
Yeah.
But, I mean, people make assumptions, and that's all it is assumptions before they actually read the facts.
Some bigger news that's more recent. Fans of the PT demo.
PT demo.
Have started developing their own game. Basically, before Konami went full-on retard, the father of Metal Gear, Hideo Kojima, and the director of Hellboy and Pacific Rim, Guillermo del Toro, were collaborating on a new game in the Silent Hill survival horror series. And they released a demo called PT on the PS4.
Is that what it's called?
Yeah, they released a demo called PT.
Okay, what's PT stand for? Do we know?
There's been a lot of speculation about that. I'm not entirely certain.
Maybe it's in the story. Kind of a spoiler thing if you knew or something.
You basically walk through a house, a photorealistic house, and you're going down the same series of corridors, and you open a door, and it's the same series of corridors over and over again, and they get progressively darker, more sinister, and more frightening each time. And it's freaking scary. I watched PewDiePie play it. And so the project was canceled by Konami. And then these other developers got together and they started making their own called Allison Road.
Right, so the Konami was working on this and then they canned it.
They canned it. A very high profile game done by one of the biggest directors in Hollywood right now. And the creator of Metal Gear.
Par for the course when it comes to Konami.
Working together, yes. And I've seen a little bit of video of the game, and it's scary. Basically, it takes place inside a house. It's all photorealistic graphics. Sort of a combination of gameplay between PT and another game called Five Nights at Freddy's, where basically you're trying to survive for 5 nights. In a house that is horribly haunted.
Who are you going to call? Ghostbusters, we're sorry that number has been disconnected.
I don't know right now what platform it's going to be for. I'm assuming it's going to be on consoles, maybe PC. Based on the graphics alone, I would say they're probably using the Unreal 4 engine.
Possibly. I've seen some pretty good graphics on there.
It looks realistic. Looks photoreal. Like you're inside a house.
Kind of a virtual walkthrough thing. Good quality graphics.
Yeah.
But that helps immersion. That helps kind of bring your believability into par with what you're doing. That's what makes the jump part. Make you jump.
Yeah. And our last bit of news. The latest hit on Steam right now is not GTA 5.
Oh.
That's the actual name of the game, not GTA 5. It's a parody, and it plays like the classic game Snake. It costs only 74 cents, and all proceeds go to a charity called Peer Productions, which helps to get children involved in acting and stage plays in theater.
Oh, not GTA 5. That's its actual name.
Yeah, that's
quote, its unquote, actual not name. Not GTA 5.
Yes, that's its actual name, not GTA 5. And all the proceeds for the game go to charity.
Now, what kind of game is it?
It's played like Snake.
What is Snake?
You've never played Snake.
I've not played Snake. What is Snake?
Basically, you move around the screen. You try not to hit your tail.
No. Okay. I got you.
I mean, it's like one of the...
Modern day light cycle from Tron.
Pretty much. I mean, next to Pong, it's like one of the oldest kinds of video games.
I didn't recognize the name, but I recognize the playstyle.
Yeah. And our main subject of the show today is Final Fantasy XIV, Heavensward. At launch, like, last week.
Yes.
Actually, we were a part of the early access.
Yes, I got an early... Actually, the servers for me were actually pretty good, but I was on Diablo, so everything...
Surprised how well they handled it. We still had login queues, but we did not have...
I've heard others had a few minor issues, but in general, overall, it wasn't too bad. At least I didn't experience any issues, so I thought it was good.
Yeah, Square Enix handled this a lot better than they did the launch of 2.0, which... The fact that we're even here is amazing, considering what happened with Final Fantasy XIV.
The beginning was rough.
Yeah. Final Fantasy XIV, the original, you had to have a crisis-capable machine just to run it originally.
Originally, the 1.0 days, I actually bought my computer for the intent of running Final Fantasy XIV 1.0 way back in the day when it was just Final Fantasy XIV, because the specs were pretty much ungodly. And even then, there were laggy menu issues and all kinds of fun stuff.
Yeah, yours was like a quad SLI at the time.
Triple. Triple SLI.
Yeah, triple SLI. Triple SLI at the time. SLI,
but yeah, it was triple SLI at the time. It was like trying to overkill these specs on that. And actually, in the modern, I forget where he mentioned it, even Yoshi P said they were aware that people bought high-end machines to be able to play that particular game.
Yes. And it was, it was really busted. The only quests that were in the game were guild leaves, and you can only do a certain number a day. And
yeah, there were guild leaves. I think there was some main scenario. I never got very far in the 1.0 stuff. I just fell off the bandwagon pretty early because the game was dull. I mean, honestly, there was nothing to do. And literally cookie-cutter environments and stuff. It was like, okay, who made this? Because, amateurs could have done better.
Yeah, because you, you run down a road and you see the same bush and the same fence.
The only fascinating thing about it...
Rubber stamped along
the way. The only fascinating thing about it was that the zones were all contiguous except for major regional shifts. That it was, it's more common in modern games, but where you'd walk out of the city and there were no zone lines, and everyone's like, "Whoa, no zone lines!"
Mm-hmm.
And that was about as far as the excitement went. After that, it was like, if you can grind and grind and grind and continue to grind and find a few parties and find the few dungeons and get on the main story. Quite frankly, I learned more about Final Fantasy 1.0's story through Ethis from YouTube's videos than I ever knew, which is great backstory, by the way. I'd recommend it to understand what happened before 2.0 to get that backstory, because it kind of plays into the 2.0 story. You get that backstory in there.
Yeah. Now, we have 2.0 because Yoshi P went to the community and said, what do you want us to do, fix the game or start over? And the community said, start over.
Yeah, they said basically rebuild it. Start up, ground up, rebuild it.
Yeah.
And the way that they did it was quite fascinating, because what they did was they took what happened in 1.0 and they introduced new events. They introduced Dalamud and basically brought about the end of the world, essentially. And basically had a final event where that was it. Dalamud crashed, your player was sent into oblivion, and you were left wondering what happened for the next however long it was.
And that's in the opening video with Susan Calloway singing Answers.
Yeah, which in is the background. One of the best tracks. They have not yet been able to do that song justice, even live.
Dragon Song comes close. Actually, Dragon Song, I think they will be able to do live.
Dragon Song will be very easy to do live. Dragon Song will be actually quite lovely live, I imagine. Answers is, you need a band, you need a rock band, you need a huge butt choir, and Susan Calloway in order to do Answers live justice.
Yes.
It would be extremely difficult. But yeah, Answers is a beautiful song.
Yeah. We've played through 2.0 since almost day one. And now you've finished 3.0.
I'm caught up on Heavensward. My bard's now level 60. Yeah. I have yet to do the end game raids, but that's because I've been leveling all my other jobs. Yeah.
I'm 56. The next quest in the main story is level locked at 57. So I'm having to go through all the side quests in Ishgard right now to get my character up, my bard. And
side quests, Muggles. That's all I'll say.
And
Muggles.
To say the main story has been really good so far.
Oh, it has been excellent. I've played a few other games. I've played the Final Fantasy 1, Part of 2, Part of 3. I've beat 4. I've seen parts of 5. I watched my cousin play 6. I've played 7. Never could grok 8. Loved 9. Got most way through 10, but the way the game was designed, I kind of got stuck, not leveled up enough and just couldn't grind it. Loved 12. 11 had good story. So, I will say one thing about the 14 storyline is after a certain point, it really, really begins to take on that old school style Final Fantasy feel that you really feel like this, you really get this, this is a Final Fantasy game the way it ought to be. This is a true Final, if you've loved the classic Final Fantasy storylines and the Final Fantasy storytelling, when you finally get into Heavensward, you will start experiencing that. It's a little thin in 2.0. Once you get about patch 2.3, I think is where it starts, you start seeing prerequisite or pre-story to 3.0 is where it starts to begin. You start introducing characters that you're going to, you know, travel with and stuff. And when you start getting about 2.3, 4, and 5.5, and then, well, the cutscenes of 5.5 were stellar, and then 3.0, it is amazing after that point. Amazing storytelling, really, really good.
Yeah, the ending of 2.5.5 is essentially the end of the original 2.0 story arc.
It concludes a lot of stuff, but they have come very good at opening threads that they just leave hanging, and they keep you coming back for more because they open a thread. If you're a story buff, they'll open a half a dozen threads and leave you hanging for the longest time on most of them, and then they'll drag on a story for a long time. They've introduced stuff in the 2-point series patches that they're going to need, that they did not finish in the 3 series patches, that they're going to need to tell. There's some stuff yet undone. So more storytelling, more story, main scenario quests.
Yeah, and those ending cutscenes is essentially a movie.
The ones at 2.5, yes, they are very long. Watch the cutscenes. Yes. Watch. Do not skip. If you're skipping cutscenes, you're going to kick yourself because you're not going to know anything of what's going on when you get in Heavensward.
That's because what happens very deeply shapes what happens in Heavensward.
Yes, it does. It sets up a lot of stuff. There's a lot of setup. And some things are resolved. Some things are not. It's very, very good, though. Watch them. Watch cutscenes. And especially 2.5.5, those last couple cutscenes, they are well worth it. When it says set the time aside, set the time aside. You're gonna want to.
Now, to be able to get into Heavensward, if you're playing, you have to have a level 50 character, and you must complete all the way to level to the patch 2.5.5.
Yes,
quest.
You have to get before the dawn done, and the 2.x patch line is as long as 2.0. So when you start getting in, people start going, "When do I get to Heavensward? When do I get to Heavensward?" And I've had that happen a lot. I've had to help a few people, where it's like, you get done with Ultima Weapon, and you're only halfway there. You've got a numerous number of primals, trials, done a couple of dungeons, a handful of small duties, and it's going to seem rough at first when you get to 2.1.2.2, because it's going to feel like the 2.0 days, where it's a lot of fetch quests. But, as I said, when you get about halfway, 2.3, 2.4, 2.5, things really rocket upward. So they start pulling you in deeper. Things start happening. Things get interesting. And you do less fetching, more storytelling. Mm-hmm. So you got to hang in there, hang with it. My feeling is to anybody, take your time. It's a Final Fantasy game. Enjoy the ride. Enjoy the story. It's a Final Fantasy game in every sense of the word. Everything that represents, it really is. Enjoy it.
Oh, the early access started on a Friday, and I think by Saturday, we were seeing level 60 characters already.
Oh, people were like, there were people that were done. They had main scenario completely blown out of the way. They had already got a level 60 character. How they managed to get to the Gauntlet of Moogles, I'll never know. And then they were already like an I-160 working on I-180, and I'm like, I'm not that crazy.
Oh, I mean, I don't see how anybody could rush that fast for this game. And if you rush through it, you don't notice it. I mean, you played the game. Okay, did you notice it?
I mean, it's one thing that people like to be world first and all this other jazz. But honestly, my feeling is when you're so much in a hurry to get to the finish line that you really, you miss out. I mean, because you're going to have to be skipping cutscenes and everything else. It's just going to go by in a flash. My comment to the person who does that is, that's great, congratulations, nice, well job done. A, did you notice anything? And B, you're going to be bored now for the next 3 months to when the next patch comes out.
Because Alexander is not coming for another week or so.
I think we're just at a week or slightly under now. I mean, I think they're only releasing, what, easy mode first or normal mode first. I'm going to put out extreme afterwards.
Is that going to be all of Alexander, or is that going to be just a portion of Alexander?
It'll be all about, well, it'll be Alexander they're going to give us. My guess is we're probably going to have, my understanding is we're going to have turns, and they'll probably have more turns. It'll probably be like Coil in that regard, my understanding is.
Binding but, Coil Bahamut, about like that.
Yeah, they'll probably release them every other patch like they did with Bahamut. I think we're going to 3.5 or 3.6 with the 3.0 series, so, my guess is it's going to be, you know, by the time we, in about a month or so, we're going to finally have all of it in place. And people will be, you know, have already finished it, you know, within a week at best. They'll already be done. And it's like, they'll be running around going, I'm bored, what do I do now? I'm like, well, if you didn't play it in such a freaking hurry. But that's my thought, to each their own, I guess.
I've been pacing myself. I have not been rushing things. The game is going to be there for the next several years.
Yeah, so. We got 4.0, 5.0, so 6.0, 7.0, 8.0, 10.0.
The new areas are beautiful.
They're big.
I
will say that, you know, even though you fly twice as twice as fast than you walk, you're twice as fast in the air than you are on the ground. And despite that, it feels like it takes me longer to cross, say, the Churning Mist or the Sea of Clouds. It takes me longer to get across that on flying than it does to run across a zone in the old 2.0 areas. That it's actually longer flying across. They're that big. So if you're on the ground, you're going to be a while getting from point A to point B. They are big.
Oh,
big zones.
Oh, Western Korathos is like twice the size
It's large, but I think, the biggest ones feel like Churning Mist feels big. And maybe just because of the way it's done, it feels big. And Sea of Clouds feels big. They feel like pretty big zones.
Sea of Clouds looks big. It looks enormous.
Yeah. And then I don't want to say the name of the last zone because it can be a spoiler for some folks. But the last zone is actually fairly large and actually requires flying at certain points. So you'll have to be able to do that before you can actually progress at that point. Flying is not required until then. You can actually get away with not, but it will be much easier when you do.
And also, I've noticed this time around, Square Enix has kept to certain themes with the music. And
the music's
very
lovely.
Good music.
Music is very lovely. I forget that last dungeon has the same music as the weapons demo, and it's very, very good. And all the music is just excellent in this. There's some really nice tracks in there.
I think it's the Ethereal Chemical Processing Plant.
And the Ravana track is absolutely stellar. Especially the second half. The second half of the Ravana fight.
Yes, they did get the lead singer of Rammstein.
Yes, they did. I was like, is this guy truly singing like this? Or have they modified his voice or something? It's like, no, he really is singing that. He's really doing it. I'm like, wow.
Yeah, I've listened to Rammstein before, and that's definitely him.
I should go back and check the credit rolls and see if they got them credited for that song.
They might have.
I'm going to check. I haven't done it. I'll go back and check the credit rolls at some point and see if they've actually done it.
Oh, and I like the art design that they've been using for Heavensward. We've seen Ishgardian architecture for a long time in Camp Dragonhead. But Ishgard itself is very good.
Yeah, they did a really good job. If you were a Final Fantasy XI player, you'll recognize the pillars area to be very familiar looking in a way because it kind of harkens back to Juno.
Oh, it definitely has a very Juno.
It has a very Juno feel to it.
The way the music is done and the how there's these pillar walls on the outer edges.
And the bridges.
In the distance. The bridges.
And just the drop over the edge kind of look. It has a very Juno feel to it.
Yeah.
They kind of intended that to be kind of a center of, a hub of activity.
And the upper level, I think they call it the pillars.
Yeah, but the pillars and the lower level's foundation.
And the music in foundation is awesome.
Yeah. The music all around is really good.
Yes. They keep two specific themes. Although, I've heard the music for the Dravanian hinterlands, the day music, and it's sort of...
That's a little weird.
Weird.
That's a little weird. That one is kind of a little odd. But there's also a track in there that I don't want to give the name on because it would be a spoiler, but you will be surprised. I will only say that it comes from a prior Final Fantasy game, and it's a very good track. And they did, you know, adding old stuff into it can be tricky, but they did a beautiful job with the music, the location, and the character. And it was absolutely fantastic part of the story.
A new addition to the game is DirectX 11 support, which is the first time that Square Enix has done this for a Final Fantasy game.
Before we actually got a graphical upgrade.
Yeah.
The most pronounced that if you've done the Arcanist quest line, and you've done, I think, level 15, I think it's the 15 or 20, it might be 20, where you're on the boat with the pirates, with another character. Look at that scene with DirectX 11 on, and look at that scene with DirectX 11 off, and you will very vastly, very quickly see the kinds of things that they were doing. I mean, it's the most pronounced than any place I've seen in the entire game. It's like, wait, this scene looks entirely, entirely different. But just going to the dungeons, I know just going through, what was that called? Stone Vigil.
Mm-hmm.
Like when you get around by the ice, those ice sprites that pop, you know, before it was like, go around the corner, but now you have like the sunlight shining in and it's just illuminated better. Even old content looks better, all around. So the new zones look incredible. The old zones look better. It was just, they did a good job. There have been some weird, tiny issues every now and then, but I think they've patched a lot of that up. I've only seen it a couple times, where sometimes, like, on my character, or especially Dark Knights, I was seeing this where the graphics had major glitches, but I think they might have already patched that up.
I think there was, like, texture pop-in.
There were some bizarre issues early on. I think they've probably patched a lot of that up already.
The game had god rays before, but they're more pronounced.
Especially in the new zones. I think the new zones are deliberately more pronounced, because I've noticed it's especially stronger in new zones.
Yeah.
But the old zone, you still see it as significant.
Yeah, the sun glares brighter in the sky when you're looking at it. I mean, overall, the lighting is significantly improved.
Yes. I still wish they'd fix the shadow maps. That's my opinion. I still wish they'd fix the shadow mapping.
I think they did that for performance.
Probably did. That would be my guess, because true shadow lighting would be intense, and so at least they have it as an option, maybe.
And I like flying, though they lock it behind the main scenario quest. You have to find these ethereal air currents. Now, there are some that are out in the world, and you basically use a compass to find them, and the compass gives you general directions to go to get to them. The rest are locked behind quests in the main scenario.
Yeah. There's a lot of them you have to find with the compass. There's like, I don't know, 10, 15, 20, something like that. There's a bunch. Then there are 5 per zone, 4 of which are quests. Some you have to really hunt through the different quests, and there's a lot of quests. And then what I kind of tended to do was I wouldn't even bother looking until I got to the main scenario quest that actually unlocked it. And you can pretty much guess what that's going to be. You started getting the memo pretty quick. It's like the main dungeon or event for the zone. Because what they're doing is, how can I put this without spoiling it? They sort of have you on a journey. And the main scenario is guiding you through that journey.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so they're kind of limiting kind of what you can do, where you can go, to stay on that journey to keep the story intact. And then once you've passed that point, they give you that last current, and that just throws open the zone for exploration. They said, okay, you've followed the story. Now go look around.
Yeah.
And you'll need to after a point, because you'll need those quests and stuff that are available for leveling up.
Oh, I've definitely noticed that. After you get through the first major area that you travel through, the next zone you go through, I'm not going to name it just because it would be a spoiler. Next zone you go through, they literally lead you like breadcrumbs.
That was the breadcrumbs thing. That's what I called it, breadcrumbs, where in order to keep you on the road and actually walk the road and do the journey, is they were actually breadcrumbing it, where they would have battle circles.
Yeah, where, the encounter rings.
Encounter rings. Where they, in order to progress, you had to walk from counter ring to counter ring. So they were breadcrumbing you, going, come on, this way. this way, come on, this way, do the journey, come on, walk with me here. So they kept you on the road during that time.
Yes.
So, yeah, I mean, you could still wander off, but they're like, can't fly, go stay here, follow the road, do the journey, okay, now you can go look around.
Yeah. You had to do a separate quest to get your company Chocobo, your grand company Chocobo to fly.
It was a side quest, yeah.
Yeah, a side quest, and also the fat Chocobo does fly, and it's like,
I haven't tried mine yet. I haven't tried mine yet. I don't know if that unlocked with it or not. I haven't seen a quest
yes, for it. Yes, it does. It unlocks it? Unlocks it as well.
Okay. Wasn't there three? I think there was three that they... Oh, the classic Chocobo, but I don't have that.
Yeah, you get the Chocobo bred specifically to fly. Then your grand company Chocobo gets the ability to fly, and your fat Chocobo. And we were in early access, so we get the Griffin.
Yes.
I like the Griffin.
Actually, Griffin the Griffin is a deluxe or collector's edition bonus.
Yeah.
Early access was for pre-order. The Griffin was for the collector's edition.
Yeah,
it's worth it. I loved it. I loved it. To me, my Chocobo feels like he's gonna throw me off over the edge. Like I'm like 5,000 yams up, and I feel like my bird's about to toss me. But that Griffin, I love soaring.
Now everyone pretty much already know. Most people already pretty much already know that. You're getting a personal airship in this, but I don't really use it. I don't really like it.
I don't like it much. It feels clunky.
Yeah, it's clunky because you see directly behind it.
Yeah, it's clunky.
You need to adjust the camera some so that you're looking slightly above it.
Or some other angle. Yeah, it's clunky. It call it a personal airship. It's really just a mount.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even, considering what airships are, I don't even really classify it as an airship.
No.
Quite frankly, I'd rather fly the wings of Palaquin than that thing. I can't wait to put that thing in there for flying. But, there's a lot of mounts that need to be adjusted that can fly. They're doing that eventually.
There's the Airman that,
the
flying eyeball.
The flying eyeball. They're gonna fix that, I think, in 3.1, where existing mounts can fly that have flying. I'll tell you what I'd love to see as a mount, since we're talking about flying mounts. I will, whatever it takes, I will do it. Just hand it to me. If it's whatever, I'll get one. I'd like to see a Pegasus, a flying horse. On the ground, his wings are folded like a Pegasus, and you fly in the air, he unfolds his wings like the way the Griffin does, and that would be absolutely stellar.
You know, if anything, Square would probably give that to Astrologians, which, speaking of which... Three new jobs were added to the game. The Machinist, Dark Knight, and Astrologian.
Yes.
The Machinist being a ranged DPS and party support. Basically a bard with a gun.
Bard with a gun.
Dark Knight, the new tank.
He's the pew-pew bard.
Yeah, Dark Knight, a new tank. And the Astrologian is a healer, and I understand it plays a lot like White Mage.
It's closer to White Mage, but I was watching one of Mr. Happy's videos, and he did a video on that recently, and his take on it is the White Mage side of Astrologian is actually kind of the way to go. The shield side of Astrologian is very weak still. They need adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
There's some RNG along with them, too, that kind of makes them a little bit more challenging to play. They need balancing. A lot of things they need balancing, but they do too. They need some love.
Now, the main mechanic of Astrologian is the cards.
Yes, and that's the biggest part of the RNG.
Yeah. Which, you pull a card and you get specific buffs that you can hand out to other players.
Yeah. It, very RNG on that.
I haven't unlocked Astrologian, but I did unlock Dark Knight, and a lot of the abilities you start out with, most everything creates enmity. And that's our cat.
That's a cat.
Most everything creates enmity with Dark Knight, and Dark Knight's pretty squishy, too.
Dark Knight, to me, feels like kind of an alternate form of Paladin, in a way. I mean, I think with a little more DPS. They have that circle AOE. I forget what it's called. I call it the reverse flash. So anybody who's a DC comic fan, I call it the reverse flash. Because it's basically darkness, so it's like it's flash, but dark. So I call it the reverse flash.
You hear this almost chorus-like sound playing, and then this black ring.
Black ring. Form. It looks awesome, though.
Yes.
I enjoy it in the way that I used to play Soul Calibur. There's a lot of Soul Calibur influence, but I won't say where in this game. But especially with Dark Knight, if you've ever played Soul Calibur or Soul Edge. In the arcade or on the PlayStation 1, 2, and 3, that it feels like Siegfried playing it with the way he manages that big giant sword. But I love it because when he's in his stance with his weapon out, he holds it the way Cloud does. And I've got the Cloud Strife gear. I want my Buster Sword. I want my Buster. Where's my Buster Sword? Where I want my Buster Sword.
Well, with Final Fantasy VII Remake on the
way. I'm going to get my Buster Sword then.
I'm pretty certain that, I'm fairly certain that Square Enix is going to have a Final Fantasy VII event.
I'll make my Alra's hair yellow so I can stand in the Strife gear with that yellow spiky hair with that big giant Buster Sword. I am golden then. I will be Dark Knight for life after that.
Now, I used a, what did they call that potion?
Fantasia?
Yeah, I used a Fantasia to change my character from my Mokeet to an Aura.
Yeah, I did that with an Elizan. I wasn't going to. I was on the fence. I mean, when the benchmark came out and they had let you play with the character creator to kind of play around with Aura designs, I wasn't going to do it at first. When I first got the benchmark, I was like, I was looking at the Aura and I hated their look. I actually did not like it. I thought it was just terrible. The horns and everything. I was just like, this is just like, just terrible. And so during the maintenance, when they were giving us the big patch for 3.0 and that we're down for 24 hours, I was bored. And I needed my Final Fantasy fix. So I went ahead and started. I figured, I was like, okay, I'm going to put my, what do you call it, the benchmark and just run it on loop or something just to, you know, pretend I'm playing because I was just wanting to do something. So I started playing with the character creator. And I was like, let me play with the Outlaw some more. Okay, so I started making it. And I had this one look. And I was like, okay, well, this looks kind of cool. So I put that to the side, and I was running the demo. And I noticed that the character that I created was in the benchmark. I was like, oh, well, that looks kind of cool. And he's got this white paint for the eyes that take on the lighting and glow of the environment around it. And the last scene where the lead character turns back and looks at the party and is like, yeah, we're about to kick this big dragon's butt. He had this look of his eyes like it were glowing and this grin that was just cool and evil and awesome all at the same time. And I was like, sold. So I saved the look. I saved everything off. And then so the first thing I did when I got into the game was I applied that look, and I've been that way ever since. And it's been awesome. Everybody who's seen it loves it.
Oh, it took me about an hour to redesign my character. I mean,
Alra's are challenging to look right.
Yeah, I've had. She is tiny.
Tiny. So they're smaller.
Alra females are tiny.
Yeah.
Whereas the males are like almost as tall as Rogadin.
Yeah, they're big. Not quite as tall as Rogadin's, but they're close. The females are not quite as short as Lalafell's, but they're starting to. They're getting down there. They're pretty small.
Yeah, and I've been glamoring my gear as we go along. I mean, the first gear they give you in Heavensward, because they literally throw high-level, eye-level gear at you.
Yeah, they really supported you on your trip up. If I have, with the exception of a handful of couple of dungeon pieces I was able to dig out of a certain couple of dungeons, I just made the item level requirement for the final dungeon. I didn't have to go looking for anything. I think I might have bought maybe one piece, maybe, the whole time. Everything else they give you.
I only acquired a few pieces using Allegan Tombstones of Soldiery. I've already bypassed that. I'm already eye level 30, which was the previous cap.
Yeah. And I'm eye 142.
I'm pretty much coil ready.
Well, coil ready, and that coil can be overpowered now. Just unsync and you're done.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if you... There was some strange limit... Strange... As far as the unsyncing goes, there were some strange places where you could and could not use it. There seemed to be some dungeons that are still locked that you can either the person wasn't doing it right, or the dungeons don't sync. I'm not sure what the case was, because some things we just, like, we did a Leviathan, because we're trying to help somebody else get the main scenario, and we did Leviathan hard mode, unsynced, and it was like, yawn. Did anybody notice we fought him? it was just like within seconds, he was just ripped apart. Well, we're not even in-game gear, and we're just ripping him.
Well, when you're I-130 or I-140, and you're like, what level's Leviathan at? It's like...
Well, normally you'd fight him back when... Probably do him in I-90-ish. You can do it comfortably.
Yeah.
Or am I I-80 or something? Some people might laugh at that statement, but whatever. I mean, as I said, comfortably. I mean, I'm sure if people want to challenge it, they can always item sync themselves down or something.
Oh, yeah. Now, and Machinist, I've played some of Machinist, and I may go back and play some more, level it, maybe when I'm finished with Bard.
I have some thoughts on Machinist. Because Machinist, I think what I was a little disappointed in, what was amazing to me is they have RNG in their main rotation, and I'm just not a fan of that. When they said they had ammunition, and then they said they had all these debuffs, well, in my mind, it made sense. I'm like, okay, they've got a bullet that makes it silent, a bullet that stuns, a bullet that, you know, knockbacks, you know, they would have all these different ammunitions for all these special effects, because you wouldn't want them spanning all these special effects. So that's kind of what I thought. What we got was the RNG on their main rotation, and the ammunition just guarantees their main rotation works.
Mm-hmm.
And then all these other abilities are just there with their own timers. And I looked at that, and I'm like, what? I was just kind of stunned that they have RNG on their main rotation, that the ABC combos where the, you know, one follow another, and you get a buff combo for doing the rotation properly. Yeah. I'm like, why did they do that? It just made no sense to me. I mean, I was just dumbfounded.
Yeah. All reload is essentially, it's like the Bard's straighter shot. It's a critical
actually,
hit
that's
bonus.
A hot shot. Hot shot? I think it is hot shot. That's the buff. That's a damage buff. Reload's just another round of ammunition. Yeah.
Well, it gives you five. It gives you five shells, and then there's a quick reload,
which gives you one.
One.
Yeah. And then they have disassemble, which I forget, or reassemble, which I forget what that does.
Yeah, I've played it a little. I went out to Costa del Sol and did some fates out there with it, and I think I got like one or two levels.
I love their AOE though. That.
Oh, yes.
That's fun. I mean, even if it's not that powerful, it's fun to watch.
Now, we don't have the turrets yet. The turrets, yeah. They don't follow you. You place them down, and they can either do DPS, or you can have them do, like, TP, or I think even MP regen.
Yeah.
Just like Bards.
They basically drop Bards. from what I understand, and this is kind of what perplexes me, is... You know, Square is going for homogenization in this patch. You can see it across the board in a lot of different jobs. And what gets me is Machinist does not seem to come close to Bard's basic functionality when it comes to these songs. What I've been told is that the range on these turrets is not the same range that a Bard has. That would make less sense to me because a Bard is mobile. He can move around and that AoE can be moved with him, where you drop this, you know, I mean, I guess unless you put it in the right spot... You're not going to get the buffs. So, and it still costs them, you know, various drawbacks. And then, of course, there's the other stuff with that, too, that you get at level 52, which I guess we'll get to eventually here.
Yeah, there's the very controversial Wanderer's Minuet and Goss Barrel.
Yes, Wanderer's Minuet.
They essentially do the same thing. They give you like a 20% damage bonus, but... Basically turns Bard and Machinist into a turret.
You're a caster now, essentially. Get over it, because it's not going anywhere. I have heard that Yoshi-P has commented that they are going to take a longer look at that. Basically, what I'm guessing is, there are two things that I'm thinking they'll do. They've actually mentioned the cast time of Wanderer's Minuet is way too long. 3 seconds is just intolerable.
It
rips your DPS into shreds.
It rips the DPS to shreds, and also it just kills your pacing.
when you're under Wanderer's Minuet, you've got to time yourselves and you got to do your abilities in a different way. But the cast time is what is atrocious, because that just stops you completely. And they are going to change it. I'm hoping they'll do it, say, as long as Swift Song, and it really will behave more like a stance, like a cleric's dance. The other part of it is the fact that several abilities are gated behind it. They fixed the bug where it said Sidewinder needed to have Wanderer's Minuet.
Mm-hmm.
They changed the tooltip, not the functionality. They meant for Sidewinder to work without it, so that's great. But definitely, at level 60, I have found that with it all together, it is pretty potent. It does take some getting used to. It is very situational.
Which suggests they may have built the job at level 60 and never really tested to see how it progresses.
Yeah, the progression part was kind of broken. And that's the part they said they're going to focus on, is the progression. Because they say when you get it, it's very underwhelming, and it very much is. And it's jarring for a bard, because you're used to your mobility, and then suddenly you're tight, you're rooted in spot, and it doesn't feel natural it's just hard to adapt to. The other thing, what was the other thing they were going to fix? Minuet's potency. This is the bigger dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
Is when under Wanderer's Minuet, because you lose auto attack and they changed barrage, because of those two things, what happens is your DPS is on a dummy, virtually just tiny, tiny, tiny portion more. I mean, just a sliver more than your DPS that you would do without it. And if you're moving in a fight, forget it. Your DPS is going way, 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 way down.
Yeah, and I think in the forums, people said that auto attack accounts for like 25%.
It accounts for 25%. Depending on how you play, it used to account, and nowadays I think it's even less because of barrage changes, but it would count for about 20 to 23% of your damage, and Wanderer's Minuet only gives you a 20% buff. The potency of the buff that Wanderer's Minuet gives you is another thing they said they were going to look at in order to increase that. I'm probably guessing they're going to give us 25, but I'm really crossing my fingers for at least 30, and 40 will be probably not going to happen.
And barrage used to be a status effect that increased your auto attack to like 3 hits at a time.
Yeah,
still does that, but until you do your next action on the
weapon
skill cooldown.
It's tied to a weapon skill. The auto attack was that's where it really buffed it, because you would do 3 auto attacks. I think it was originally 10 seconds or 15 seconds. I forget the original countdown. But for that time,
I think it was 10 seconds. It didn't last very long.
No, it was short. But for that time, you'd get 2 or 3 rounds of auto attack. So you were hitting quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Without it now, tied to weapon skills, its potency is way down. You really have to time it with something like Imperial Arrow now. Now, it can't crit, but, you know, I've done 3K of damage on a single strike. Now, you know, Dragoons and all of them say, oh, well, that's nothing. But, well, you know, that's 3 strikes every whatever the countdown for that is. You time it well. You can't use it with Sidewinder. I wish you could, because I've seen Sidewinder do some pretty sweet numbers.
Yeah. I've basically reserved it almost for Imperial Arrow.
Yeah, that's all I do. I don't. I let Imperial Arrow fly under normal circumstances as part of my rotation, but when I see Barrage starting to close in as far as being ready, I will hold off on using Sidewinder so that they're both lined up. Because it's, you know, if I do it right, I don't lose much DPS. It might be like a couple seconds or something. Yeah. But I find that it definitely has a big effect with Sidewinder.
Yeah.
Another thing that Mondra's Minuet's good for, and this is where I'm still, especially if you're not 60 yet, when you get Iron Jaws at least, it's good for AoEing. You can, if you can mix it with Army's Paeon, you can go and AoE and AoE and AoE and AoE, and you can just keep going. You don't have your TP drain like you used to.
They increased the TP cost for Wide Volley, but lowered it for Quick Knock, and also buffed Quick Knock.
Quick Knock is different in that it is less expensive than Wide Volley, and the same potency. So it's got the advantage of it's cheaper. It does require you to be more positionally dependent, and they changed, they tied Reign of Death to the Bloodletter proc.
Yep.
So when you have your dots on, you basically you're trying to be able to spam it according to that, and you save TP doing it because it's free.
Mm-hmm.
You just got to get your proc up, and you get that from your dots. So AoEing is a little different now. There's very little situations where you'd use Wide Volley anymore.
Yeah, the main difference with Wide Volley is you can AoE from a distance, but with Quick Knock,
you have to actually be
up close and personal.
You have to be up close personal in order to get it positioned right. The range on it's pretty nice, but you still got to be fairly... You can't just stand way, way back. You do have to be somewhat closer and a little more in danger.
Positioning is important with Quick Knock because it only has a certain cone.
It's a cone in front of you instead of just an AoE around your target, so position matters a lot more. And that means you're running into position, which means you're not shooting anything else if you've got Wanderer's Minuet up while you get into position. Once you get started, you can let it rip.
Yeah. And pretty much everything we've been talking about, Goss Barrel does the same thing.
Goss Barrel's the same thing, but I've not used it yet, but from what I understand, it's like Bard in a lot of ways. Not used it yet, though, so I really can't say too much, and that it has the same strange issues as Wanderer's Minuet.
Now, with 3.0, every job has had some kind of change done to it. I don't know everything.
I don't know everything yet. There are so many things that they've done. Different people can comment on the different stuff, but there's a lot of different things going on there. Some things are still broken. I've heard Warriors kind of gotten tangled up. Dark Knight's a little tangled up. Ninjas are loving theirs. Summoners are like AoE kings now. Black mages are like, what, WTF? So there's a lot of different things all over across the board. Square's going to spend the next probably 6 months rebalancing everybody. We're all going to get, some are going to get nerfed, some are going to get buffs. It's going to be like screaming and gnashing of teeth while everyone kind of gets adjusted ins and outs.
Well, Black Mage gets that casting buff.
They have the ley lines, They have the ley lines. So if you thought bards were rooted, black mages are rooted more than even that when they use that.
Well, black mages barely move as it is because you can't move while casting.
But they, at least with a normal buff, they carry the buff with them. Here, you place a buff and you have to stay still, and you know some AoE is going to chase you out of your ley line, you know, area, and you lose it once you leave it. So
I have not seen what any of the other changes are yet, because I mainly play Bard. I play a little bit of... My other character was Black Mage. I may go back to Black Mage at some point. But I also
You wouldn't have
Bard
level, because you were already 50.
Yeah. I would have to level that one, because it's not very high. I think it's like 15.
What's that?
My Black Mage.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I would have a long way to go.
Oh, you're talking about your Thaumaturge, because you're not having a job yet.
Yep, my Thaumaturge. And there is a Mac client for Final Fantasy XIV, but most people can't run it.
Yeah, I've heard pretty bad horror stories, so if anybody sees this thing, is it actually working, or is it just DOA? Because the stories I've heard that people have tried to run this on high-end, expensive Macs, really high-end stuff, and they can't get this thing to work right. Frame rates, if you get to 25 frames a second, you're actually doing pretty good, I've heard. So I don't know if these are all just horror rumor stories, or if these are just occasional, or if this is just the general consensus that this thing sucks. But everything I've heard about it, I've not heard anything good. I'll just put it that way. It's all been pretty negative, so they botched that one.
Yeah. It's not a native client. It's basically using a wrapper called Cedar. It was made by Transgaming, and Cedar is basically based on an old product they don't make anymore called Sedega. And Sedega is a commercial implementation of Wine.
Yeah, that all just sounds like a bad idea, but just that whole chaining all that thought together, it's like, no, it should have been native, they should have went ahead and spent the time and the TLC time. It would have been a lot to support, but it would have been better off doing that. And one would think with the Mac side being very, you know, running on Intel now, you'd think that wouldn't be a no-brainer, but they should have built a native client. They really should have.
Yeah, they really should have.
They need to go back and they need to give those folks refunds or something, because
they don't make Sedega anymore. They dropped it. In fact, they're selling the technology to NVIDIA.
That should give you a warning right there with how bad it was.
Yes. And Endgame.
Not got there yet. Well, I am level 60, but I've not ran any of the new content yet because I've been busy leveling other classes.
The new raid, Alexander, is coming soon.
Yeah, we don't know anything about it yet. Everyone's kind of scratching their heads going, what's it going to be like? And we're waiting on that. I think a lot of our job balancing that we're going to get is probably going to depend on the performance in Alexander. I think that's where they're going to, that's what Square's looking for is they let it out to see how people handle the jobs, get them used to it, then throw Alexander at us, and then look at the results of the good, bad, and the ugly mm-hmm. of Alexander and the job performances in true in-game content, and then adjust accordingly.
I'm wondering if they're going to have as many turns in Alexander as they do in the Coil.
I thought they were going to do four. I thought they were going to do four each. That they're going to get four turns.
Four turns?
That's what I've heard. I mean, I may be wrong, but I thought it was going to be four turns.
There are like 13 for Coil.
Well, there would have been 12, but there's that turn three that nobody wants to speak of. When I was originally trying to learn about Coil, I was like, where's turn three?
I've unlocked the story quest for it, but I have never been in there.
I've been in a few. I'm up to turn 9, but I never bothered with the rest of it.
But my eye level was not high enough for it. Now I am, because of Heavensward.
Yeah, probably a great time to go back and just overpower it.
Yeah.
You'll be capped at 6. You're capped at 50 unless your party decides to low-level it.
Yeah, because I'm at the old cap of I-30. Now it's like I-80 is the new cap.
Currently I-80 with an I-90 weapon, I think. Yeah. I think you're balanced because I think they said there's only one ring. Excuse me, I think there's only one ring for the slot. So it's probably like, I don't know, 175 ring plus a 180 ring plus an I-190 weapon. So you probably balance out at 180. I've not pursued it. I've not gone crazy with it. I really want to level my other jobs. I'll get there. For me personally, getting my XP is kind of more important. Yeah. That's more permanent on my character now.
All right. And we're several months still away from a 3.1 patch. And patches for this game, for Final Fantasy XIV, have always included more main scenario story.
There'll be more story. Airships will be opened up to be able to use, finally, rather than just... Our free company has built a couple of airships. I know we've got one done. I think they're either working on or finished the second ship. Right now, it's like, okay, it's Ventures on steroids. But they supposedly are going to allow us to go to new areas with the airship. So I think right now, I mean, some free companies are doing it, but I think once you're able to start going places, a lot of free companies may pick this up and go like, I want to go there. Especially they start dropping good materials and stuff. Mm-hmm. The costs on the market board are crazy, crazy, crazy. I mean, if you want to make a little bit of Jill right now, there are so many materials required to build these, and common materials, lower level materials that are required. Mm-hmm. You can make a little bit of money on it right now if you want to make some Jill. There's prices are crazy.
And for a while there, level 30 gear was like through the
roof. Oh, that was crazy. I'm like, people are stupid. You're like, why go to the market? You're going to level in that gear for all of maybe 5-6 levels, and you're not going to care about it after that. Why go to the market and spend crazy quantities of gel for low-level junk when you can just go to the vendor and pay one tiny fraction of the price and just pick it up off the regular NPC vendor? You're not going to wear it very long anyway. You're going to get past the level range, and you're going to be 40 or 50 and just chunk it in the can anyway. So why spend the money? But I don't know. People just...
That's because the new jobs start at level 30.
Yes, the three new jobs start at 30.
There are no prerequisite classes other than what you need for cross-class abilities.
I don't know if there's actually any job level requirements. The requirement to get them is already pretty steep in the fact that you must, in order to play Astrologian, Dark Knight, or Machinist, you have to be able to get into Ishgard.
Yeah.
Which means you have to be pretty far along in the main scenario in order to even get them.
Well, you have to finish the main scenario.
To at least before the dawn, yeah. You have to get there. 50.
Yeah.
2.0 has to be done before you can get to the 3.0 jobs.
It's not like WoW where you can just jump into the new content.
There's been a lot of different things about WoW as far as this goes. I've seen some forums where a lot of WoW players are like, wow, about Final Fantasy. So,
The one thing I've noticed about Square Enix is they have been trying very hard not to be another WoW.
Yeah, they've taken what's good and used that and they've not taken the stuff that was kind of iffy. I'm not a WoW player, so I really can't comment on all the stuff there, but from what I've been reading and stuff, people are kind of, they basically, the complaint was that the current release of current expansion on WoW was underwhelming. So basically they're like looking at their own game and seeing their expansion being very underwhelming, and they're looking at all the great news about Final Fantasy Heavensward, and they're going, that's kind of looking kind of appealing right now. Because what I got here in front of me is kind of like, eh. So that's been something I've seen on forums. I don't know if that's the common consensus, but I've seen that in certain forums. So.
Yeah, this so far has been probably one of the best Final Fantasy games that Square Enix has released in a while.
Overall, I'm happy with it. I think they've done a good job overall. There are, you know, various minor issues, but that's true with, you know, whenever things come out. But I think overall they can count this as a pretty good success. I think they nailed it in the story. They still got some issues with some jobs. In-game is on its way. coming soon. Please look forward to it. Hi.
Mr. Happy had another video where we were talking about the next live letter is coming.
Yes, they're going to give more information. Oh. I watched his announcement for that, and he basically is going to, they're going to have some live translations available on his stream. Yeah. So, you know, check that out.
Yeah, they're going back to the all Japanese. They're all going back to the all Japanese language. Live letters. They're not doing the English on during the show like they did during the E3.
Yeah, they kind of did need that because that was a wider audience that was paying attention. Now they're back to their Final Fantasy core base, and so they're like, okay, we're just gonna do our old school thing again.
So luckily, they do have several really good translators.
There's some good translators out there. So, and they also what they do is after a while, if you don't get the translations, they do post on the forums what the content essentially of the letter was. So.
They basically put it on the Final Fantasy.
They put it on the forums, so that way you can see what it was the announcements were. But for live, you need to find either know Japanese or find one of the live streams that are live translating it.
You know, I had created a list of notes for the show for us, things for us to talk about. There's something I didn't add, but I've been wanting to talk about, and that is Jill Sellers. I've noticed
RMT.
RMT. I've noticed that there hasn't been as much RMT activity.
It's been a mix. Some days it's better than others. It seems to be hit and miss. They have continued the continual spamming. The one thing I've noticed is I haven't had any random friend invites. They did finally fix that.
That was annoying.
That was very annoying. I still get the random tells. They could still add better options for managing that. That would be nice.
Yeah.
But it has not been as prolific, although I know today it was a little more. So it's hit and miss with them. Some days it's better, some days it's pretty terrible. So. But at least the friends invite, the obnoxious friend invite thingy is a little less.
Yeah. RMT, or real money transfer, was a big problem in Final Fantasy XI. In fact, it devastated the economy at one time. I remember we were playing, and it was several years ago, and it was around Christmas time, and the economy was just completely in the dirt.
Yeah, there were days.
It was bad, and that was back when, she wants attention. Mm-hmm. That was back when, Square Enix implemented this team that was meant to deal with problems with RMT. They put this task force together specifically to go after them because they were becoming a very big problem, and they were ruining the game experience essentially.
My feeling is one of the best things they could do for 14, as far as RMT goes, is they need a report and block. We have a blacklist.
Yeah.
But Square expects us to use this blacklist, and the problem is it only holds 200 names, and there's no delete all. Mm-hmm. So after a while, it fills up, and then you have to sit there and manually mess with it over and over and over, and it's a complete terror.
Yeah.
What they need to do, and this is real simple, I don't know why they're not doing this, but add to blacklist a report and block. This is a separate kind of blacklist that if enough people report the same spammer, they, you know, get spammed. Where, you know, if it's like some kind of thing where if it's enough people, I mean, enough that would be over a threshold that a group of people couldn't abuse it by, you know, trolling an individual player, but enough that it would, the minute a person gets too many of these report and block type of spams, that it does sort of shut them down so that way Square can, you know, look into it. And, you know, at least a countermeasure that if somebody, if the people do abuse it, you know, and troll somebody, that they themselves will get, you know, banned or something. So that way you, you know, there's no incentive to want to troll somebody. But at the same time, be able to quickly block these spam and make it worth reporting.
Yes.
Make it worth the time to say, block, 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 block. Okay. You know that they've spammed about 10 other, 15 other people. You know, they're not coming back.
Now, I know that those using the, there's the demo of the game. Not essentially a demo, but it lets people play the game for a short period of time.
The free trial.
The free trial.
Yeah, the free trial.
And you can't do anything with that. You can't send friend requests. You can't send tells.
You can receive friends requests, but you can't reply with tells. You essentially just have to play the game. I mean, there's nothing else you can do. And most I've seen those used for is people standing around Arethrites, say spamming.
Mm-hmm.
And in the markets, I've seen them say spamming there. At least we don't have to worry about those groups in Heavensward because they can't get there.
Yeah.
So we know that at least they have to spend money on it in order to be anywhere in the Heavensward areas to even attempt that.
Now, there are... There used to be out in the Shroud, I think in the cat. There used to be in the, what was it, the North Shroud? It was there near
the the Sprite Killers.
Yeah, the Sprite Killers. I don't understand why they were doing that.
I really don't know. I don't know if this was on other servers. But I know on Diablos in the North Shroud, just outside the Beastman Tribe camp.
Yeah.
There's a ring there. It's kind of the ruins of some kind, where there's this small batch of what are they? Some kind of sprites. They look like little globe sprites. I forget what they're called now. And you'd have a white mage, a bard, and a couple of other things, and they would sit there and just spam auto kill that over and over and over. And one ability that drives me most crazy is Bard's Holy. It drives me, not Bard, but White Mage's Holy.
Yes.
God, I wish we had it. Anyway, holy crap. Anyway, they would just stand out there and just constantly just do this over and over. And being anywhere near that would just be mind-bendingly. You just want to just take them and throw them into the pit somewhere. I think they finally nixed them. I think it's finally stopped. I haven't seen it in a long time, but for a while there, it was pretty awful.
And they were all part of the same free company.
It was all the same free company.
It's gone now.
Yeah, it was like... And they had the free company tag of 66666 or something like that.
Yeah.
I forget what the name of them were. It was like five members, and they were all out there doing it. Of course, occasionally, they'd have this abotted, and eventually the resources would drain, and you'd come by, and they'd all be dead on the ground.
Oh.
Or somebody managed to pull a tree and kill them.
I've seen them dead a few times.
Yeah, somebody'd pull a tree, and they'd catch the tree at just the right moment, and they'd go after them and kill them or something.
I have not seen many resource-gathering bots.
Some people say they're still there. I have not seen them, but they say they're still there.
Hmm.
They're just in different places, usually underground.
Hmm.
They're miners are truly miners because they are underground.
You can't see them stealth mining.
Stealth mining, yeah.
Yes. And, you know, the fact that you immediately, when you log into the game, sometimes you almost immediately got a RMT.
Yeah, those are bots. They need to squash that.
You know, there were times where I got like 5 or 6 friend requests a day.
Report and block. They should add it.
Yeah. And all they do with that is spam your in-game mail because people cannot send you mail.
Dave did that once. He inadvertently accepted one of those.
Yes.
And his mailbox lit up like a Christmas tree. I mean, it was like within seconds.
Yeah.
It's like, God.
It's like they'll spam the crap out of you. They're desperate.
Well, here's my awesome thing. I was talking about the other night. I said, I don't know if this will work. It'd be fun if they did it, though. Is Square monitor these, find one of these groups that are doing it heavy duty.
Mm-hmm.
And then what they do is they do a sting operation. They wait until the sale. So when they see that the money's start to move to the player, and then intercept the money. So the players bought the gold.
Yeah.
And then they block the transfer itself so the player can't get what they've purchased. So that the player now has spent their money, and yet the jail sellers now have to throw more money at them, and they block, they catch that. And they do it again and again. So what happens eventually is, if you're a jail buyer, you say, okay, I'm tired of all this. I want to craft. I want to go buy me some jail. You buy some jail. You go to the website, give me all your information, your account, whatever it is you have to do.
Yeah.
And they're like, okay, go here, whatever their instructions are. You go there. It's not there. You're like, where's my money? I spent my money. Where's my gold? Where's my gold?
Where's my jail?
Yes, give these guys a bad rap that everyone knows that Square's intercepting the golds. If you try to buy jail, they can't get it.
Mm.
Give them that bad rap.
Oh, yeah. Because these guys, it really mucks with the in-game economy.
It's not as severe in 14. It's more... I wouldn't even care. Even if it was shout chat or if it was say chat, I wouldn't care so much. It's the tell chat that drives me bananas because it makes communicating with other players difficult.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for that, I wouldn't care so much. There's not a whole lot that they do that really impacts me that badly, except for that. It makes trying to communicate with somebody else difficult. Because it forces me to, in order to block it, because there's no filtering tools in the game, it forces me to block it by going on busy status, which really screws more up. It's more detrimental. So that's why it's a problem. If it wasn't for that, it wouldn't be such a big deal.
Yeah. 11 was very dependent on Jill for just about everything. Whereas 14 is not so much so. I mean, there's not a lot you really need to spend Jill on except for maybe
housing. Well, there are some very expensive things.
Housing.
Housing is expensive. There can be certain kinds of gear. Crafting materials can be very expensive under certain conditions. Mm-hmm. It's more of a thing for crafters, really. Because a lot of your in-game gear, the crafters can't do. Yeah. They've never, Square's decided never to let crafters be able to do that in-game gear. They're never going to let them do it. So it's more vanity, crafting certain types of materials, making kind of different kinds of items. It's all in the crafter side of things. So crafters are far more impacted by this than just your average player just doing in-game content and gearing up through that process.
Crafting for housing, making walls,
crafting for housing,
furniture,
the airships can be very expensive. The airships are crazy because the materials you need in there are difficult to deal with.
And you have to have a party of crafters.
That was the unique thing about that. Just a comment is that you had to have four people. They meant it to be an entire system. It's involved. It's a whole involved system, and yet we've yet to see everything they're going to do with it. So,
You have four people, but one person is doing the work.
No, well, you have to have four people in order to... All you really need is four people during the progression part of the step.
Yeah.
The gathering stuff anybody can do.
Yeah.
Somebody sets it up, whoever's got permissions, then everyone can deliver the materials and they get XP for doing so. And then once it's all been gathered together, everyone needs to join up in order to progress it. This is meant to keep me companies from abusing it and jail sellers and stuff, but I don't want to affect them any, but I think the biggest detriment right now to the whole thing is there's not enough housing or it's people to have houses to even do the system. I mean, if you're a new company in the past 6 months, you don't have a house, more likely.
Yeah. And so, someone who's starting out with this game, what would you recommend?
For anybody who's new, anybody who's just literally, like, say you're coming from World of Warcraft or Elder Scrolls or some other MMO, and you're hearing about how great this game is. The thing I always tell new people, that because they ask a million questions about how do I get this, how do I get this, how do I do this, how do I get this, follow the main scenario story. That unlocks just about everything. It will unlock the dungeons, most of them.
Mm-hmm.
It will technically it unlocks all of them in a way. It unlocks the dungeons. It unlocks trials. Mm-hmm. It unlocks chocobos. It unlocks retainers. It unlocks your job class system. It unlocks the cross-class system.
Yep.
It unlocks Heavensward. It unlocks flying. 90% of your questions will always be, how do I get something done? The answer to 90% of that is main scenario quest.
Yeah.
That is absolutely the main thing. Follow the main story. It will guide you through everything. Now, some MMOs have all this other stuff spread out, and you don't have to do that. But in Final Fantasy XIV, 90% of it is main scenario stuff.
The only thing that's separate from the main scenario is maybe the hard and extreme mode dungeons.
And even those, in a way, because you can't do those until you reach level 50. You can be level 50 and not have that.
Yeah.
You have to be able to get the main scenario done. You have to be done with a quest called the Ultimate Weapon. And when you're done with that, then all these side dungeons at 50 pop up. You're seeing quests will just, all of them will just start coming into view. The primals, you step through them, all your side dungeons, everything. The Heavensward, all those dungeons, get to level 60, and you do the main scenario. There's all your stuff there, in-game. All main scenario.
Yeah.
The only thing that's off the main scenario that you need to work on is whatever job you're leveling, there are usually two jobs that go along with it. One will be a requirement to go from class to job, and then there will be a secondary one that's not required that usually will have a couple of extra skills. So if you're just focusing on a single job, you will still need to level another job at least somewhat, a little bit. Some 26, some 34. Bard's got the weird one with Monk at 42.
Yeah.
That's the only one that's that severe. The rest, 26 to 34, and with the new leveling increases and stuff, it goes quick. So, but that's the only thing sideways you got to kind of do that's kind of a sidetrack. Also, follow the main scenario. If you get level locked for some reason, do side quests, but preserve some of these side quests for a secondary class. That way you have a little bit of leg up on doing them. Start out with your hunting log, which again, main scenario. Do some of that early on, 10, 20, 25. After that, it doesn't really matter as much. Fates,
yeah,
all that.
Definitely level. In fact, I've seen something in this game that I haven't seen in a long time.
What's that?
Fate stampedes.
Yes, even where I'm leveling at 35, I'm seeing the herds. I remember it was one with Korathoth. I was like, oh my god, I haven't seen this since the 2.0 days. It was like this just complete swarm of
Zerg Rush,
where it's just literally like, if you've ever played StarCraft and you've seen the Zerglings, you know, where we get the term from, Zerg Rush. When you see a fate and it's like just a whole bunch of people just all coming in on Chukubu back or whatever mount they happen to be riding and just swarm it. Yeah. Haven't seen that in a while.
Dragon fight in the Steel Vigil in the north of the
Korathoth. I bet that's crazy. I haven't been up there yet, but I bet that's crazy. I know that I was trying to help the free company gather, and it was kind of funny because it was almost like a comedy. It was like, I was in the middle of northern Thalin. We were trying to get cobalt ore. And we're standing there, and then suddenly this, this herd going south. There was no fate where we're at, we're just going south. And then going north, going south. It reminded me of a video that was a joke about the, you know, game companies, where it's like, all these people are gathered around, and somebody points, I got the new game, and they all, like that. And I'll run to it. It just reminded me of that, and I'm like, "Yeah, this is so fun."
Oh, I know that video. That used audio from SpongeBob, and the video was from Gary's Mod, and it was about EA. It was hilarious.
And honestly, this horde of everybody going from one side to the other made me think of that video as they were all charging to the next thing.
In fact, if you search EA in a nutshell on YouTube, you'll find it. It is hilarious.
Yeah, it's a good video. And this herd of people running from point A to point B past what we were doing was so funny. It made me think of that thing.
Because there used to be Fate Stampedes in Quarrymill.
There used to be those in the Korathoth Highlands. I was a part of them when we would basically we would rush to the that ogre fight in the belly, yeah. And then we would rush up to the Steel Vigil to fight the dragon.
Yeah,
and those are back. Those were gone for
now,
a while. And
a couple things. This is why I'm leveling my classes right now and not doing in-game content, because I feel like these herds will disappear eventually.
Yeah,
and I feel like I'm going to be able to level faster with these herds going on. So I'm taking advantage of the fact that they're still around. They're going to be around for another couple of weeks at least. So I'm going to take advantage as much as I can of them.
Yeah.
The fates, though, interestingly, and they're probably going to nerf this at some point, somehow,
yeah.
Is the fates in Northern Thanalan are more efficient, XP-wise, than the fates in the New Zone. And Mr. Happy was talking about this, where the fates in the New Zones are so far apart, you actually earn more XP an hour running around in that little bitty zone at level 50 plus than you do running trying to fly from point A to point B in the new zones, and you don't the XP reward is not much different.
And you would literally have to be able to fly to do them, because if you're trying to
you'll never get there. They'll be done before you have to be able I'm assuming you're trying to level a secondary class or something.
Yeah.
To say you've got your for me I got Bard, so let's say I'm taking Machinist through there. I wouldn't take it to the new zones. They're too far apart, and there's not enough of them. I mean, I've literally, there's four or five fates across the entire zone, and I'm I'll never get there in time. Right. Whereas, in Northern Thanalan, you're just going fate, back and forth, what I was talking about, and you get XP faster.
Yeah. I've been in the Churning Mist, and I've seen fates and no one around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've seen them all. There's one that happened right outside the main city in the western Korathos.
Oh, what's it?
One that happens right there.
The, I get the name of it. Dragon's, the Falcon's Nest.
Falcon's Nest. It happens right outside Falcon's Nest. There's one there.
I've done a few of those, but I've not done as many. They're so far apart.
There's so many people there, because that's the starter zone for
Heaven's Word. Yeah, they're just right outside the door, and you can grab a little bit of XP.
Just this bleak, frozen waste.
Yeah.
But, and then there's a lot of new players because of the PS4 version.
Oh, the number of sprouts. There's so many sprouts, it makes you want to grab a... makes your botanist self sort of get kind of itchy to start swinging the scythe, because there are so many. It's amazing how many new people there are. It's going to be interesting. The game's going to be busy for quite a while with so many new people. I'd be curious to know where they all come from.
Yes. Yeah, I was surprised at seeing how many new people are in the game, but this is a really good game. I mean, Final Fantasy XIV, it's not the most unique MMO out there compared to other MMOs, but it's... They take a lot of ideas from other games.
I would say it's well-polished.
Well-polished.
It's well-polished. It still has its edges, but, I mean, anything that's always in an active state of work is always going to have its edges. But it's still overall a solid game, well-polished through and through.
Yeah, it's had its ups and downs. I mean, they've got a lot of lore to draw from other Final Fantasy games. I mean, they brought in the Gold Saucer from
Final Fantasy VII. Gold Saucer, Crystal Tower... Yeah. The other places I don't want to name yet, because main scenario spoilers.
Oh, definitely. I mean, and there's the Primals, there's Garuda, Titan, Ifrit from past Final Fantasy games.
Mm-hmm.
Odin, which they recently buffed. There's two ways.
I don't think I fought him. Did I fight him? No. I remember. I thought I fought him once, maybe.
Yeah, because there's two ways to fight him. One, occasionally when he appears in the Shroud.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the Black Shroud, and you know he's there because you see the
whole
sky
shroud.
Gets darkness.
Yeah, the weather effect's called gloom. It looks like the cloud effect, but it's purple.
Yeah,
kind of greenish purple.
If you don't get him beat down fast enough, he'll use his ultimate attack at the end, and basically he can wipe an entire area.
It was so funny because we. Our party, I did the Odin Urus Font fight, and we were so close to losing that fight. Literally, he did his death animation, where he's basically going to slash and wipe us.
Mm-hmm.
He does it, and then it fades back in, and we're still standing. And I'm like, oh my God, that was too tight.
Double KO.
we survived. We did survive. We actually got him just in time, but it was so tight that he actually did that, the fade out, and you had that slash. And then it fades in and we're the ones standing. I'm like, oh, man, that was tight.
Because that's that separate arena style. That's the separate arena style fight with Odin.
Yeah, they should add an Odin
Extreme. He's not as powerful.
Yeah, they should add an Odin Extreme.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
Because that one where he's running out in the shot, I mean, I've seen him just run by and just bodies fall.
Yeah, you don't want to catch Argo on him. And it's easy to do as a bard. I've done it so many times, I've caught Argo, because you live long enough to acquire hate. Mm-hmm. Because most of the other tanks and anybody else who's within melee range have all been sliced down. So as a bard, you sort of stay farther back, and so you wind up living a little longer, so you eventually wind up pulling hate as he's slicing everybody else down.
Because as he's running around, everybody's got to rush up to him to hit him, mm-hmm. while we can just sit back and just plunk him with arrows.
But he's sliced everyone else who's had hate, so he's on his way.
Yeah. Oh, I stay far back.
I'm undefeated on him. I've actually managed, and I actually got gold in that. I got the 5 mantles, and I actually managed to be undefeated.
Yeah. He was, what level he was? I know.
He would bounce around, level. Depending on how often he would come. He'd bounce around. I've seen him as high as level 60. That was when the cap was 50, and he just slaughtered everyone in the area. And I've seen him as low as like level 54. And the thing is, nobody's doing it anymore. Last time before the patch, I don't know if they've done it since, but there was one point where nobody was standing there, and I was on my Slipnir mount, because I bought one. I went and got one. I love it. Works well with my character. I literally came up right behind him, right to his left side, best back just to stay just out of his vision cone, took a screenshot, and ran like hell. So I got a screenshot of me just camping out. And on the Slipnir mount, you do the same fold your arms thing that he does. So I'm standing there right next to him. Got my screenshot and ran.
And the hunts are more important.
There was some drama today, and I've posted some stuff. I sent Square a note on this because I was in Eastern Lenosha, and what I noticed was notification times for hunts. There are tools that allow people to instantly know when these hunts are popping.
Yeah.
And so you had people showing up. They're like, oh, we've been here for 5 minutes already. Everyone else was like, we just now heard about it. And so there's an unevenness in the notification. And so I sent Square a recommendation of, we have a compass in Heavensward that tells us where the Aether Rites are.
Yeah.
And we also, when we're near a fate, we get this indication, fate's been discovered nearby. Kind of a combination of those, where it's a hunt compass.
Yeah.
And what I feel like is what it would do is it wouldn't tell you exactly where it is, and for like A ranks you would get a hunt's been discovered nearby, and for S ranks you'd get a hunt has been identified in such zone, and then anybody doing the hunts can maybe buy one of these for like 200 seals or whatever, and when they have it on their character, when they have it in their inventory, they get these messages. Mm-hmm. They can take it off; they don't have to get these. They have it in their inventory, so that way they can be notified that there's a hunt. Players still have to find it, but everybody doing hunts gets an equal notification that it is occurring. And that way you don't have this, well, my link shell is better than yours. Can I have a link shell, please? And all this other drama that was going on at the time. And it wasn't about anybody's ability to do it. It was about notification times.
Maybe have it as a key item tool, sort of like
it could be. I mean, you could do it as a key item tool. I mean, the only reason I had it, something you could turn off, or not something you could, not like the Aethers where you have to use it. It would, when you have it on, it would function while you have it enabled.
Yeah,
and so that way you don't have to have these notifications when you don't want them. But they would give you alerts to, if you're in the same zone as one popping. You know, for like A ranks, you get the message, a hunt has been located nearby X number of yams to the west. Okay, well, you know it's in that direction. You can at least go start scouting it out. Everyone is in that zone gets it. So there's...
Yeah.
And then for S ranks, because they're so rare, basically, it says a major disturbance has been indicated in Eastern Thanaland, for example.
Yes.
And so, okay, you know, at least go there. And then it can say, hunt located X number of yams to the west, or whatever. And so everyone gets an equal opportunity to get there on time. And then when the hunt pops, it's untargetable for 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And that way, everybody has a chance to gather, and then everybody has an equal opportunity. If you don't go after that, then, well, there you are. And it doesn't tell you exactly where it's at.
Now, these are necessary for, is it the I-80 gear that it's necessary for?
They've done some things with the hunts. I know that the new ones are required for upgrading to I-180. The new hunts and the new zones. Yeah. And this compass I'm talking about would be especially more useful in there. The old hunts...
I have yet to see an S-rank mob for the hunts in the new zones, but I've seen plenty of A-ranks.
I know you still have to do the old hunts. I know that the old seals are still valuable for a reason, but I do not know why. I know that they are still required for some reason, but I'm not sure off the top of my head what it is. You still need to do them. I know I've seen people still wanting to say they're still relevant. Yeah. They've kept... Square's good about keeping old content relevant, and they've kept the old hunts relevant. I just don't know why they are off the top of my head.
Yeah.
They changed that somehow, and I haven't explored it.
Yeah, because someone who is still leveling a character through the main scenario 2.x, now they're going to need higher level gear, and I don't know if I haven't seen the state of...
old systems are still generally in place.
The soldiery...
Well, soldiery's gone.
Soldiery's gone?
It's all poetics now. My thinking is, based on what kind of the way things look, we're going to have probably... permanently three sets of tomes. I don't think we're going to have two anymore. I think we're going to have three sets. I think poetics will be it. I don't think they're going to make any more changes to 2.0 content. So basically, like Crystal Tower, all the dungeons, the main scenario, roulette, all those are still going to reward tomes because you're going to need those for gear. And I've heard they've made other changes that they give you more gear in the main story. I haven't replayed that to see what they've done.
Yeah.
So I don't know how a new player's experience goes to these the first time through. I've heard you get a leg up because you're still getting, if you've got the expansion installed, you still get XP, so you'll be 52, 53 by the time you get into Heavensward.
Yeah.
So it'll be a little easier when you do that. But I think the gear, like the ironworks and stuff, is still relevant. And you kind of can go on that for at least 52, or actually, no, more like 54. I didn't start replacing gear until almost 54, 55. It's when the gear started to become relevant to me. So, because I was in mostly 120, 130 gear when it came out. So,
now the low level dungeon daily bonus in the duty finder, does that still grant the tomes? I know that you earned soldiery by running them. Did they give the new tomes running?
I have not done it since I hit 60. I have not looked at the screen. I'm not certain. It just hasn't come up within since the time I've been 60 that I've tried to run it. I don't know for certain. Believe it or not, I actually don't, because I've been more busy leveling the other jobs on Fates, because I feel like it's more steady to me personally. Because the XP's been buffed, so.
Because I haven't done that.
I don't know.
I haven't been doing the daily since 3.0.
I'm sure someone can leave in the comments early access. What it is. Most people probably already know, but for those who don't, I don't know.
Yeah. Because I haven't done any of the dailies since 3.0 launched.
I did them, but I did them before I was 60, and it was just poetics at the time.
Okay.
So there may be I know that you need the expert roulette in the higher level dungeons for law, for sure.
Yeah, and people used to... Square's got a problem where they have to be careful that people don't abandon the old content. And basically lock lower level people out of getting into Heavensward.
It's less of a critical thing if they have a higher level friend.
Yeah.
Because that's what we did. Because in our little stint when we helped that person with Leviathan, we only had 7-member group. And we were unsynced, and not all of us were 60 yet, and we tore it apart.
Yeah.
So I imagine somebody in I-80... You know, you need about, maybe you could probably do a hard mode in I-80 with a 4-man group. Probably easy.
Yeah.
So, I mean, some of these 8-mans are now 4-mans if you do them in high enough gear. Yeah. So.
Yeah, otherwise you need at least I-90 gear in order to do Steps of Fate.
Well, that's the minimum requirement, but yeah. I think it's fairly easy to reach now. It's not as challenging as it was. They throw more gear at you. It's poetics is more common. It's easier to get the Ironworks gear. It's much, much easier to get into that because they're trying to make they have to keep the story sort of in order, so the main scenario is sort of the lead through.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the what they give you as you level up has gone up, so you'll be easier. It won't be such a struggle to hit the I-90 requirement by the time you get to that point. And then you get to Heavensward, you can buy the 110 gear, and off you go with, you know, 130. Yeah,
you could have like a buddy go into Ishgard and buy one I-115 gear from the vendors.
Yeah, but my guess is if you're leveling... Now, the question will be, here's my thought. Here's my question. Is right now you have to do the main scenario to get from 2 to 2.x to 3, and obviously a 3x.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a question going forward. Is Square going to continue that? Where when we see 4.0, 5.0, 6.0, is it literally going to be a long, sequential story arc telling thing all the way through? Are there going to be branches, or are they going to continue, I wonder? Kind of a speculation question mark on that. I think
they'll always have the main stories, the main story, and then side quests, and then, of course, the eye levels.
I mean, it really, really looks like the main, it's going to be this way for some time. So anybody, when 4.0, I could just see the things when somebody gets the game in 4.0, it's like, okay, I got to do how much before I can get into X New Zone? Yeah.
See, because they still have, like, the story arcs with what certain enemies in the game since 2.0 have been doing.
Yeah, you still got, you got stuff left over from 2.0, you got new stuff introduced in 2.x, and then you got a whole bunch of new stuff introduced in 3.0. A lot of old threads have not been closed off, they've just left them hanging, so it's like, yeah, it's just gonna be contiguous, it looks like.
And the one thing that was conspicuously missing from 3.0 was Hildebrand.
Give it time. 3.1, 3.2.
Hildebrand is popular.
3.1, 3.2. Somewhere
essentially,
in there.
For non-Final Fantasy XIV players, Hildebrand is essentially take the Naked Gun and the yes. The Pink Panther move, the Pink Panther movie.
Yes.
And bring
yes.
it into Final Fantasy.
Yes, that's what he is.
Yeah,
he's awesome. Everybody loves Hildy. Hildy and Greg. Hildy and Greg are awesome.
Gilgamesh. That was a crazy fight.
That was awesome.
Gilgamesh.
That was awesome. Greg was so much fun.
Yes.
And Ultros, yes. Oh, absolutely. For certain types of fans, for certain types of content, Ultros was to die for. He was awesome.
Pervy octopus, that's all I'm going to say.
Even that might be a spoiler, but I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to pursue it. I don't want to change your rating on your show, so.
Yes. Well, the one thing I can say is someone who's looking for a new MMO experience that is different from World of Warcraft and different from most other MMOs out there, I would recommend Final Fantasy XIV.
Definitely.
And right now is the best time to get into it because a lot of new people are playing the game, so there's a lot of support out there, you know, so you can get leveled, you can do the dungeons, and the queue times are not that long.
Yeah, they're really good. I had like almost an insta queue for my bard. I just was like, really?
there's no more hour or half an hour waits anymore.
At least not right now. That insta queue on my bard. I about passed out. Yeah. I was like, scared me.
The one thing that really surprised me is that first dungeon in Heavensward, the Dusk Vigil, was not on the main scenario.
Baby, they said there were going to be optional side quests. That one was optional. You didn't have to do it.
Yeah.
Well, there are two in-game dungeons that are post-story that you have to do.
Well, those are the end-game, but I'm talking about the...
As far as optional, it was the only optional. The rest are required.
Yeah. And that one was required in order to get the last...
You do have to do it the fly.
Air current.
Yeah. You do have to go there to fly.
Yeah. But I would recommend this game. Would you recommend this game to someone who's new?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the game starts you out and teaches you as you go through various content. It gives new players what they call guild hests so that you can practice being in a party before you get into a dungeon scenario. They're really short, really fast, and, you know, everyone knows that, you know, this is for lower-level players, newer people, so they teach you how to do certain kinds of mechanics.
Yeah.
And so there are ways of learning it. And then a lot of people are helpful. There are always trolls out there, but the community is very good. Get into a good free company, which are kind of what people might know as guilds. And there's a lot of help to be had there.
Yeah, it's essentially multiplayer tutorials.
Yeah, so there's a lot of new people. It's a great time to get into it.
You do have to do them for the main scenario of 2.x at some point.
There's a couple where they say, yeah, you gotta go look back at these, but yeah. They're none of it's that hard.
I think it's like hero and a half show.
Yes.
Yeah. That you have to at least get up to.
Yes, which has something to do with turtles.
Yes. Oh God, the puns.
Oh, the puns.
The guy that was in charge of English localization, he puts a lot of puns into the quest games, and it's like,
It's like if it's punnable. There's even, believe it or not, even the arrow in the knee thing is in there somewhere.
Yes, I've seen it.
Arrow in the knee.
Oh, there's so many references to Game of Thrones and Lord of the Rings. I mean, there in Turning Mist, there was one that was my precious.
My precious.
Well, you actually had to go looking for a missing ring. Yes. It's like
there. It's in there.
I mean, you thought Blizzard was bad.
They own them on this. They got them on this. Yes. If you love puns, this is the pun king.
It's a good game. The engine is not as system resource intensive as 1.0 was.
Oh yeah, the ability to play this game is much improved. And for me, I noticed that when I started using the DirectX 11 client, mm-hmm. it was much, much improved. Even on my system, I noticed that a lot of places I used to get a little bit of stutter, that it's all gone now.
Yeah.
And so it's well improved. So requirements are pretty decent. You know, most modern systems, even not even high-end systems, can run this game fairly well without requiring too much. If you can run Windows 7 or 8 or whatever, you can run this with no problem.
Oh, I've got an A10 6800K APU, and I was running the game. I've got an R9 270 in there now, but I was running the game with just the APU, and I was getting 60 frames a second.
Yeah, it runs really good. They did a good job on the requirements of this game.
Yeah, so, you know, you don't have to have a uber crisis capable machine to run it anymore.
Yes, the days of overpowering it are gone.
Melting your graphics card.
Right.
So, that's our show. This was our first inaugural Geektastic Weekly. It's a little rough.
Gametastic Weekly more, but it's okay.
Absolutely no professionalism.
Absolutely no. Don't need that here.
So, this is our first show. We'll get better at it. I'd like to do this show at least maybe once a week or bi-weekly.
We are professionally unprofessional.
Ah. And it's going to be more than just gaming. It's going to be lots of different subjects. I'm going to be looking into, you know, what we could do for our next show. Maybe make some improvements. I like the format of starting out with the news, beginning a few news segments at the beginning, and then our main topic. There's not a lot of shows like this out there. There are plenty of reviews, plenty of Let's Plays. I mean, everybody's doing stuff like that. And there's not many, you know, we're just two guys just basically sit and just talk about stuff.
I know of one so far. That's it.
Yeah, there's one.
State of the Realm's pretty good.
State of the Realm, yeah.
Yeah, Mr. Happy.
Let's focus specifically on
Final Fantasy, but it's not. It's geared toward that mostly, but not as generic as far as cross with tech and other news as well.
Yeah, because that's the focus of the show. You know, we're gamers, we're geeks. We'll talk about, you know, gaming, tech, latest news, and all that. And that's what this show's all about. So I think we've had a good run this first time.
I think so. I think we did all right.
Of course, everybody listening to this is going to hear the cats. But
bad cats.
Yes, three cats that are desperate for attention. All right, and
Hope you enjoyed the show. Geektastic Weekly will be a bi-weekly program discussing the latest news in entertainment, games, and technology. If you liked what you heard, please consider subscribing and hitting that like button. See you next time.